بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. السلام الله عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We got some exciting news today. We have learned that the University of Birmingham decided to radiocarbon date a Quranic manuscript fragment that they've had in their collection for nearly 100 years, a century. So better late than never, right? So what they found is that carbon dated this manuscript fragment of the Quran dates to smack dab in the lifetime of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now this is remarkable. We've had numerous manuscripts and manuscript fragments that have dated to the first century Hijri, the first century after the Hijra, which is the beginning of the Islamic calendar, but nothing so definitively quite yet. They usually grade it based on the writing style and circumstantial evidence and such. This is actual scientific carbon dating, and it's a wonderful thing. Now, it reminds me that God says in the Quran, أعوذ بالله بسم الله العلي من الشيطان الرجيم إن نحن نزلنا الذكر وإن له لحافظون, that verily we have revealed the dhikr. Now, dhikr means rumination, mentioning, invocations, and it's a reference to the Quran. We have revealed the dhikr, and we will be the ones to protect it. It is a principle in Islamic belief that the Quran is unalterable. It has remained the same for the past nearly 1500 years. Now, that's a claim we make, but God be praised, it's a claim that science and history and scholarship and academia, nobody has been able to refute. And as time goes by and research increases, it seems that they're actually substantiating it. So about this verse that I mentioned, and it's in Surah Al-Hijr, by the way, verse 41. About this verse, the famous exegete and commentator of the Qur'an, Qatada bin Di'ama, you'll find him in the exegeses of the Qur'an mentioned simply as Qatada. He has tied this verse in Surah Al-Hijr to another verse in Surah Fussilat. And that verse says, لَا يَأْتِيهِ الْبَاطِلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَلَا مِنْ خَلْفِهِ, which means that falsehood can't approach it, not from before it, nor behind it. And it's interesting that Qatada, tying this verse to the aforementioned verse, says that the batil, the falsehood in this verse, is actually Satan. He says in the tafsir as cited, he says, فَأَنزَلَهُ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ حَفِظَهُ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُ إِبْلِيسُ أَنْ يَزِيدْ فِيهِ بَاطِلًا وَلَا يَنْتَقِصُ مِنْهُ حَقًّا حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْ ذَلِكَ, that God revealed the Qur'an and he's going to protect it. And it is not possible, Satan can't even try to add any falsehood to the Qur'an or remove anything from it that is truth. God protects it from that. And interestingly enough, in the first verse that I mentioned, again, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, the part that says, وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, and we are the ones to protect it, the possessive letter ha in lahu is actually, he equates with the Prophet Muhammad. So he says about that, that this part, وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, he says is actually, وَإِنَّ لِمُحَمَّدٍ حَافِظُونَ مِمَّنْ أَرَادَهُ بِسُوءٍ مِنْ أَعْدَائِهِ, that we will protect Muhammad from the wicked designs of his enemies. And this is a beautiful thing because the Prophet's wife Aisha radiallahu anha, she said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the embodiment of the Qur'an. She said he was a walking Qur'an. So it's wonderful to see the interchangeability of the Qur'an with the Prophet. When Allah says he's going to protect the Qur'an, he's also saying he's going to protect the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in Usul al-Tafsir, you will find that there are two types of ikhtilaf. Ikhtilaf tadad and ikhtilaf tanawwa. Ikhtilaf tadad is contradiction, and that does not exist in the Qur'an. There's ikhtilaf tanawwa, which is variants that are supplementary and add to the understanding of the Qur'an. Now, this ikhtilaf between whether له is in reference to the Quran or to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the majority say it is a reference to the Quran. But this minority statement of Qatada that it is a reference to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is beautiful. So we have in the Quran a promise that Allah is going to protect this book, His literal word. So another interesting fact about the second ayah in Fusilat that Qatada cites is that it says لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه, not from the front and not from the back. Could we say that Satan, Shaytan, cannot cause any mishmash, any mess, any fitna in the integrity of the Quran من بين يديه, in the earliest times of his jama', of his collection, of the collection of Quran, ولا من خلفه, and not in our time later, 1500 years later, and up until the day of judgment, from its compilation to the day of judgment, لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. Could this be an interesting aspect of this verse? I find it fascinating. Now, for some background about this manuscript fragment that the University of Birmingham has had for nearly 100 years, it is part of what's called the Mingana collection, named after Alphonse Mingana, who was a Syrian Christian from Iraq. And actually, he was a former priest. He was a master of the Syriac language, which was the language of his people. Now, he came from Iraq. He was born in Hormiz Mingana. And he came from Iraq, you know, probably around 1913. He was born in the late 19th century, and he passed away in the early 20th century. He came to England and settled in Birmingham around 1913. Now, what's really funny, a sweet little factoid, his trips back and forth to the Middle East to collect his Mingana collection were financed by the John Rylands Library and none other than Dr. Edward Cadbury. Yes, the candy maker. So, Alphonse Mingana would go back and collect all kinds of manuscripts with particular focus on Syriac and also in Karshuni. Karshuni is the Arabic language written in Syriac characters, and as well as finding, of course, Arabic manuscripts with a very strong emphasis upon the Quran. Now, as I said, he was a very, very masterful Syriacist, a master of the Syriac language. And all Syriac scholarship ultimately goes back to him and another German scholar named Theodor Noldy. Alphonse Mingana was the forefather of this theory that became popularized in the early 2000s of the Syriac origin of the Quran. And Christoph Luxemburg came out with his book and it was just hammered and bashed by scholars unanimously. I mean, Orientalists and Muslims alike were like, this is garbage. So, but he was the forefather of this theory, and he theorized that the Quran had a Syriac prototype text that is lost, of course. It is always really convenient that, no, we don't have it, it's lost. And he had an underhanded agenda, naturally as a Christian and former priest, to undermine and disprove the Quran. This is not something we should take particular offense to. Yes, he was an academic. Yes, he had a religious objective. But these biases have always existed in academia, and they always will. So we don't take any particular offense to that. It's just a reality. And it's a reality that exists with Muslims as well. We shouldn't deny it. So for more information on this Syriac origin of the Quran, I advise you to look at Islamic Awareness's article that was written by MSM Saifullah Muhammad Ghunaim and myself, Shibli Zaman, entitled From Alphonse Mingana to Christoph Luxemburg, Arabic Script and the Alleged Syriac Origins of the Quran. You can Google it or find the link in the description of this video. So Alphonse Mingana compiled the Mingana collection. Now he got it down to two volumes and there was going on to a third, but he died suddenly in 1937 before completing the third volume. So, extant were two volumes. The Mingana collection is housed in the special collections at the University of Birmingham, and it's available there for study by scholarship. Now, in reference to this particular Quranic manuscript that the University of Birmingham has carbon dated, this is actually nothing new. Brother Saifullah, he had actually cataloged this manuscript as far back as 2009, 6 years ago. The organization responsible for carbon dating this was the Oxford University Radiocarbon Accelerator Unit. which has an accuracy of over 95%. That's nearly 100%. You almost never have that kind of accuracy for anything. Now, the youngest age that they have for this manuscript is 1,370 years, and it's likely older. Even when using the latest date of 645 AD, that places it just a decade after the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The Prophet Muhammad lived between 570 and 632. The manuscript's carbon dating places it between 568 and 645. That's almost his exact lifetime. There is every likelihood that this was written by a companion of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And I don't know about you, that just sent chills up my spine, and every time I say it, it sends chills up my spine. It's amazing that we can now say this as a matter of science, and not just a matter of history, and much less even a matter of belief. We can state it now as a matter of science. It has some substantiation through this radiocarbon dating. Now, I'm going to give you some tidbits from BBC's article because they are so tasty. Now, David Thomas, he's a professor of Christianity and Islam at the University of Birmingham. These are his quotes from the article, and they're just awesome. He said, quote, "They could well take us back to within a few years of the actual founding of Islam," end quote. He says further, quote, "The person who actually wrote it could well have known the Prophet Muhammad. He would have seen him probably. He would maybe have heard him preach. He may have known him personally. And that really is quite a thought to conjure with," end quote. Not my words, the words of David Thomas, professor of Christianity and Islam from the University of Birmingham. The article says, quote, "Professor Thomas says it will show people in Birmingham that they have a, quote, treasure that is second to none," end quote. Now, that is a rundown of this exciting news of the Quranic manuscript. I just heard about it today. I think the BBC just published it today. You'll probably hear more about it in coming days. And I will provide links for this in the description of the video. So, praise God, alhamdulillah, good news, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.